Hello, Miss Sakina?
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
We are live?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Vishnu sir, can you hear us?
Yes, yes.
You can just put your camera on, sir.
Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV, Rheumat TV Online. To introduce today's topic and speaker, I hand over to our moderator, Dr. Salim Patel.
Thanks, Dr. Neeraj. A very good evening to all our respected delegates. Welcome to this Rheuma DG Conclave. Since quite a long time, we've been doing this program every month. And as you know, in association with Rheuma TV and Ortho TV, we are broadcasting this program to many fraternities, both in the country as well as outside the country. So today we have a very interesting topic. And before I talk about the topic, I would first like to introduce our speaker of the day. It's none other than respected Dr. Vishnu Sharma. He's a consultant rheumatologist from Apollo Hospital, Ahmedabad, and as well as an honorary rheumatologist at the BJMC Civil Hospital, Ahmedabad. Sir has done multiple clinical trials on JAK inhibitors and MABs. He's been an organizing secretary of the Rheumatology Association of Goa of Gujarat Conference, which was a West Zone Rheumatology Conference in 2018. He has n number of publications to his name with multiple articles published in various journals. He has also written a chapter on pregnancy and rheumatology in the API textbook. He has been a life member of the Indian Rheumatology Association and a treasurer of the Rheumatology Association of Gujarat. Today, sir is with us to talk about a very interesting topic, that is patterns of arthritis and the recent trends in and advances in the role of DMARDs. So with this, I would now like to hand over the session to Dr. Vishnu. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Salim. Thanks for the nice introduction. At the outset, I first like to thank Zydus, Sanofi and team for giving me this opportunity to talk on this platform. So I will be talking on the basically what, as a rheumatologist, how do we approach a patient of arthritis? And what are we doing new in them is basically the, what are the newer aspects that we are using in the disease modified drugs of the rheumatoid arthritis?
So you can share your screen.
Yeah. Okay, so the, starting the main objectives will be to discuss the several patterns of the routine arthritis that we see in the clinic. And how do we approach them, where the labs in imaging fits into the presentations? And what are the pitfalls and what are the advantages of the lab testing? So starting with the arthritis or arthralgia, whenever a patient of joint pain comes to the rheumatology clinic, the first thing that we do is divide the patient to whether the patient has inflammatory arthritis or non-inflammatory arthritis. As a rheumatologist, we see more of the inflammatory arthritis, but definitely non-inflammatory also. Consist of almost 20 to 30% of our patients. So how to do that? The first and most important thing, the rheumatology is a total clinical branch. Most of the diagnoses in rheumatology are clinical, almost rather it's more than 80% of the patient we can diagnose clinically. So justly hardly 10 to 20% of the patient that we require the real the labs are required. So the most important thing whenever we are discussing any pattern of arthritis or any type of arthritis or any sort of joint pain is the history. So whenever we talk about the inflammatory or non-inflammatory pain, the first thing that we do is to take the history properly. So inflammatory arthritis is typically that is associated with a rheumatic disease most of the time. Patient will typically complain to you that she is worse in the morning, she is worse at the night, and she is much better in the afternoon or after the sun exposure. So that's the patient perception, but what happens due to the we all know that inflammatory pain is typically associated with the immobility stiffness. So after a period of rest of more than 45 minutes or 1 hour, patient starts getting a little bit stiffness, and stiffness increases with the rest. So patient feels worse in the morning, in the night, and he or she is much better in the afternoon. So that's a very typical nature of the inflammatory pain that we get, especially in the patient with rheumatoid arthritis or lupus or the other connective tissue disease. So immobility stiffness should be more than at least 30 minutes, or usually it should be more than 45 minutes to diagnose inflammatory pain. Usually these pains are better with the activity, better with the NSAIDs. And they are associated with the other symptom like fatigue, sometimes low-grade fever, or you can find them. On examination, you can find the swelling or the effusion. Well, if you talk about the mechanical pains or mechanical arthritis are typical pains that are associated with the routine strain of the joints, routine stress on the our body or strain on the joints. So they are typically at the end of the day when the patient is tired after the work or after some exertion. So they increase with the exertion. They are better with the rest. So this is the most important history. Early morning stiffness, sometimes we can find in the back pain, in the mechanical pains also, especially in the patient of osteoarthritis. But usually it's not more than 15 to 20 minutes. Then there are other, we can have the history of some trauma in these patients, then some history of locking, strain, or even overuse we can find. So the first thing whenever a patient comes to us is to first divide into the whether the pains are non-inflammatory pains and the inflammatory pains. So, and among the, whenever we talk about the inflammatory, the most important thing is the history. Then after the history, what we can do to confirm the thing, that is by the examination, the inflammatory pains, inflammatory joint are usually warm. You can see the erythema, joint swelling, you can palpate, especially in the knees very, or in the bigger joint is more easy, in the wrist and in the knee. In the small joints also, if you have the habit of examining the small joints, you can see that you can palpate the swelling in those joints. Then there are some inflammatory markers like ESR, CRP, and then the imaging, which helps in the confirming the inflammation. After that, we divide the pains into the whether the pains are the monoarthritis, whether the oligoarthritis, polyarthritis. Why we do that? Because this each pattern has got its own significance. Like whenever we talk about the monoarthritis, still the most common cause of single joint pain and swelling in India, especially in the chronic cases, is the infection or the tuberculosis. So if we rule out the tuberculosis or trauma, then the most common cause in the rheumatology, from rheumatologist point of view, is always the gout. It's acute pain. Gout is a typically monoarticular episodic arthritis, but usually gout is the main differential when your patient with a history of a few days comes to us with a single joint involvement. Whenever we talk about the oligoarthritis, the oligoarthritis rheumatoid patient can sometimes present with the oligo means 1 to 4 group of joints. So even the rheumatoid patient can present like this, but basically it's more in the spondyloarthropathy, the ankylosing spondylitis group that we see the limited group of joint involvement. Polyarthritis has got a lot of differential, which we will discuss gradually in my later slides. So after dividing the patient to the mono, oligo, polyarthritis, then the inflammatory polyarthritis. What the other thing that we see to see the pattern of the arthritis? First important thing, number of joint involved that we already discussed. Then acute versus chronic. So how it is important? Because most of the arthritis that we see are usually chronic. Acute arthritis, gout is a very specific example because it's a typically episodic acute pain. The patient will start within a day, that it will build up within 24 to 40 hours, it will maximize, then it will go away within 7 days. So that's the history of typically of a gout. For any inflammatory arthritis like rheumatoid or the other chronic issue, usually we require a history of at least 6 weeks. We usually don't diagnose those patients if the history is, or rather we try to wait if the pain and swelling are persistent at least for 6 weeks, then we go for the chronic arthritis like the rheumatoid arthritis. Additive versus migrating. What is the difference between that? Additive means joints are added. Must actually start from a single knee, then the other knee is added, then the shoulders are added, then the small joints of hand are added, which is a very typical history that we see in a patient rheumatoid. When you ask a patient, he will say he started from the small joints of the hand, then gradually the shoulder were added, then the knee was added. So it will go. So most of the inflammatory arthritis are additive arthritis, while the migratory means the pain shift from the single joint to other joints. So migratory arthritis we see in the rheumatic fever, sometimes in the palindromic pattern of the rheumatoid arthritis, we can see the migratory pattern. Persistent arthritis versus recurrent arthritis, the arthritis which are persistent, most of the chronic arthritis that we see are the persistent arthritis. While recurrent arthritis, sometimes most common example is gout, which is a typically episodic monoarticular arthritis with a variable frequency. Then sometimes the even rheumatoid, especially in the palindromic variant, can have like this. Then the spondyloarthropathies also, you can get this history. The patient had a history of knee swelling before 4 or 5 years, then it got better. Then again, he developed this swelling, which is, and it is more common than what we see in the rheumatoid. So this is again important. Then again, very important thing is which joints are involved. Is the predominant proximal joints are involved or the distal joints are involved? Distal joints means joints of the hands, joints of the feet. While the proximal means near to the axial skeleton, like the shoulder joint, hip joint. So proximal joint involvement predominantly occurs in the spondyloarthropathy group, while the distal group, distal joint involvement usually in the rotator and the other connective tissue group. So if the patient has predominantly proximal involvement, we always first think about the spondyloarthropathy group. Then symmetrical versus asymmetrical, which is again a very important. Symmetrical arthritis usually we see in most of our digital connective tissue diseases, rheumatoid arthritis, while asymmetrical usually we see in the spondyloarthropathy group or the vasculitis. So these are the important things that we look into whenever a patient of joint pain comes to it. After dividing into them to inflammatory, non-inflammatory, then the depending on the number of joint involved, monoarticular or oligoarticular or polyarticular. So now I will just with few examples, I will try to explain how we approach the patient and what is the role of the lab in diagnosing these patients and what are the variable arthritis we see in our OPDs. So most of our patient, most of the rheumatology patient comes with a pain in which are the pains in the small joints of the hand. And just a pain in the small joints can have many, many differentials. So starting with a very routine case, she was a young lady with a 42-year-old female with history of hand pains and swelling ongoing since last 12 months. She had a history of hypertension. There was no family history of arthritis. She was feeling it difficulty in doing her daily activities. She was little better with the rest. On when we examined her, she had some joint swelling and tendons in the wrist. There was swelling in the MCPs. There was swelling in the PIPs. So this is a very typical patient that a rheumatologist sees in his OPD. So how we approach to this patient? After the routine, getting the routine test done, that CBC, ESR, SGPT, which is mandatory for each and every patient, because CBC tells many things about the patient that I will explain in the later slide. And SGPT creatinine, we always require before starting any treatment to the patient. But coming to the specific serology, these are the usual tests that we ask the patient, rheumatoid factor, anti-CCP, ANA, and ESR and CRP as the inflammatory markers. So with this history and with this with these reports, there can be the many possibilities that patient can come to you, patient can have. So in the screening, you can get the rheumatoid factor positive or ANA negative, rheumatoid factor ANA positive, rheumatoid factor negative or ANA positive, or both the things are negative. Now, as I told you, rheumatology, the most of the diagnoses are clinical. Even we have the classical criteria for most of the diseases, not the diagnostic criteria. So diagnosis is clinical. Labs only helps in stamping the diagnosis. We never diagnose the patient with the labs. But definitely, if we are suspecting something like in this patient, which is history only 2 months, in the 2 months history, sometimes the findings can be missed in 1987. But in 2010, the ACR and EULAR came with the newer rheumatoid arthritis classification criteria. So the best part about this criteria is that it was aimed to whether the patient is needed to be started on the disease modified track. Sometimes we see a patient who has synovitis, but he had very mild synovitis or few of the joints, in which we confuse whether we just treat patient with the NSAID, wait for a few months, or we should start with the disease modified drugs directly. So the aim of this criteria was whether we should start the patient with the disease modified drug. So whenever you have a little confusion, patient in the early stage, if reports are coming negative, you can go through this criteria. You can see whether the patient is fit into this criteria or not. If the patient fits into this classification criteria, you can definitely start the patient with the disease modified drugs. So coming to our hand pain, where the first patient that we discussed, the second patient, she was again a young female, and most of the time we deal with the young females only. And she had a history of just 4 weeks of polyarticular pains, which was predominantly the small joints of hand with swelling, with significant early morning stiffness. There was no remarkable past history. She was meeting with two young children. There was no fever, no rash. And she had definite swelling, which was consistent with the rheumatoid arthritis-like pattern. So what we should do next? So female with a 4 months of history, usually we wait for 6 weeks. So to say the patient, whether the patient has rheumatoid arthritis or not. So we can go for the reports like rheumatoid factor, anti-CCP, ANA, ESR, CRP. So this patient came with all the reports, all the reports were negative. But again, as I told you, even we can have the rheumatoid arthritis patient with all the labs negative. But the only thing here was the patient was just had a 4 weeks of history, whether we should start on the treatment or we should wait for the few more weeks to see whether the disease is progressing and whether she developed into something else. So the, again, the, these kind of patients, the most important thing is to is the history. So I went back to the history, and these are the diagnostic possibilities in this patient. Either it's a seronegative RA, or there can be some viral like chikungunya, parvovirus, HBC. HBC virus can present like the arthralgia and with a short history. Chikungunya, we all know that definitely it all looks like rheumatoid arthritis only. And the psoriatic arthritis is a big differential in most of the joint pains or arthritis that we see. So in this patient, the most important thing was to go back to the history and see that whether we are really missing into, we're not missing something. So I went back to the history. I asked her whether how much was the, when the pains were started. So whenever you ask a patient of rheumatoid arthritis when the pains were started, he or she will vaguely give you an answer that I am getting pain since 4 months, 6 months, or something like that. But they will never be sure about the date of onset of the symptom. But in this, if the patient has post viral, especially the post chikungunya arthritis, whenever you ask them that when the pain started, they will typically tell you, "Sir, on the 10th of the October, I had the fever." Or sometimes these patients don't realize that they had the fever. But suddenly they start with the joint pains, and joint pains could be within 24 hours they develop the very stiff and the painful joint. So this patient had the similar history with that. She had a very rapid onset of symptom. She was not sure about the fever, but she was very sure about the date of the onset of the fever or her arthritis symptom. So she told me, "Sir, on this date, I started my symptom and it was very severe." So definitely, so in this kind of patient, the main diagnosis will be the post-viral rather than the rheumatoid arthritis in this patient. And what is the importance of differentiating these two things? Because post-viral or chikungunya arthritis typically looks like a rheumatoid arthritis. But the good part is that if they have rheumatoid factor and anti-RCC positive, if we treat them properly, sometimes they improve just with the NSAID. Sometimes we have to add the steroids also. Sometimes the disease-modified drugs also. Usually we wait for the 6 weeks. Till 6 weeks, we just treat with the NSAIDs only. But if the patient pain and swelling persists after 6 weeks, we add something like the hydroxychloroquine. If the patient has more than 3 months, we add methotrexate. If the pain persists for more than 6 months, then we treat them as rheumatoid arthritis only. But if this patient has rheumatoid factor and NTC positive, there are more chances that we are able to stop the DMARDs and we are able to stop all the treatment in these patients. Some of these patients may develop into rheumatoid arthritis and may own lifelong on the disease modifying drugs, especially 10 to 15% of the patient. So continuing with my hand pain story, because I said that most of the patients that rheumatologists, orthopedics, I think they see most of the knee pains, but for rheumatology, hand pains are the most important complaint and the complaint that we see in our OPD. So it's a young female with a history of 2 months of hand pains and swelling. His past was unremarkable. There was no specific family history. His examination confirmed that she had some swelling. When she came to me, she already had some lab done. She had rheumatoid fever positive and negative, NTC was negative, ESM was a little bit high. Her ANA was positive. ANA was 230, which was done from the ELISA method. Now, ANA is usually done by the two methods. It's ELISA or the immunofluorescence. So whenever you are asking for the ANA, please ask to get it done always from the immunofluorescence, because ELISA is neither specific nor sensitive. So it can misguide you. And the pattern and intensity of ANA on the immunofluorescence is very important to diagnose or corroborate with the profile of the patient. So ELISA, ANA with some joint pains, we really can't definitely rely on that. But patient had some pain, she need to be evaluated. And the most important part about this patient was when I looked at the CBC, CBC showed some cytopenias. Her hemoglobin was little low, WBC was little low, platelet was little low. Now this kind of picture we never see in a patient with rheumatoid arthritis. This kind of picture usually we see in the connective tissue diseases like the lupus or the Sjögren's or other MCTD, because most of the connective tissue diseases are associated with the cytopenia. While if it is a patient of vasculitis again can present like this. In the vasculitis, we see usually the leukocytosis or the thrombocytosis, anemia. So just by looking at the CBC, sometimes we are able to tell what disease we are dealing with. So with the patient with the joint pain, and most of these patients starts with the joint pain, especially the joints of the small joints of the hand. So joint pain, small pains in the small joints of hand with cytopenia, most likely that I knew that I am dealing with the lupus in which other symptoms have not developed. So what next? As I told you, the most important part is the history. So when I asked him when I asked him the proper history, then they showed me she was getting fever, which she was not realizing. She was thinking that pains and fever is due to the joint pain, but she had a documented fever of more than 100 degree Fahrenheit. A patient of rheumatoid arthritis should never have a fever of more than 100 degree Fahrenheit, or should never get a fever more than 7 days. If a patient of rheumatoid arthritis complains you about the fever, you should always recheck your diagnosis whether the patient has some connective tissue disease or there is some secondary infection in that patient. Rheumatoid arthritis patient, they always talk about the pains, and maximum by fatigability, but they will never say that they are getting fever, except in some very severe inflammatory patients. And also the other very important history that I got is she had a very significant weight loss of greater than 3 kg. Weight loss, we never see, or it can be due to the, sometimes the rheumatoid arthritis patient do, they go on the dieting, they start doing the all the, take all the dietary precautions. Due to that, they can lose the weight, but otherwise no. There was history of oral also, there was history of significant hair loss also. So definitely there was something more than the rheumatoid. So whenever you get a patient with a history of something more than the joint pains, like the body weight loss, fever, hair loss, ulcer, you should always think about the connective tissue like lupus or the Sjogren's rather than the simple rheumatoid arthritis. So when I got the labs done, her ANA was positive, 1:320+++ homogeneous, which is a very high titer, very significant. So I asked for the extra-level nuclear antigens for the ANA profile. We showed that DSGNA was strongly, DSGNA was positive. Her RO was positive, her SSA was positive, SSB was positive. So whenever a young patient, we joined pin with ANA positive, multiple antibodies positive in the profile, I knew that I'm dealing with the lupus rather than the rheumatoid arthritis. And why it is important to pick this patient? Because lupus is a totally different disease with the, compared to the rheumatoid arthritis, rather any connective tissue disease. These patients sometimes can deteriorate within weeks, rather sometimes I've seen that losing these patients within weeks. So it's really important to diagnose this patient on time and start the treatment on time. And they usually don't respond to the disease modifying factors of rheumatoid arthritis. They require a lot of steroids, especially in the beginning. When the disease is under control, then gradually we can taper down the steroid and then stop the steroid. So treatment protocols are total different. Prognosis is total different. We are usually very alert whenever we are dealing with a patient of connective tissue disease, because we know that we can lose this patient if we really don't take care of them properly, which never happens in the patient of rheumatoid arthritis. Rheumatoid arthritis patient, if they want to go for the Ayurvedic homeopathy, we say them, okay, if you want to try, you can try for 6 months or so, and then see, and then you can come back, because there is never an emergency to start a treatment rheumatoid arthritis, because just and the only drawback will be patient will develop some erosions and deformities, but most of our patient wants to try something. But this thing we usually not allow in a patient of SLE, because we know that if we don't start treatment in a patient of lupus, most likely after 6 months we will get this patient in ICU. So these things can be so bad. So that's why this is really important to pick this patient as early as possible to start on the treatment. And these patients usually they start with the joint pains only. So it's very really important to pick them on the early stages. The arthritis is quite similar to rheumatoid arthritis, but it's a non-erosive arthritis. In spite of being arthritis of the 2 to 3 years, they can sometimes develop the deformities, but they will never have the erosions in the X-ray. So when to order an ANA? So ANA is the not a test. Usually you should include in your arthritis panel. That I have seen many labs and many, even the consultant, they order the arthritis profile in which ANA is included. ANA is not a diagnostic test. It's just a screening test. So there are very specific parameters, so there are very specific signs and symptoms when we order this test. So whenever you have a young female with polyarthralgia with explant fever, weight loss, anorexia, some leukopenias, in those patients only you go for the ANA. You should definitely, there's no need to ask ANA in each and every patient of joint pain. There should be some specific symptom other than the joint pain in which we order an ANA. So depending on the disease that we are suspecting, we can have the history of Raynaud's, figure skin tightness, myositis, then the patient has lung involvement, then the dyspnea or the recurrent cough, patient has the pericarditis, then that there can be history of chest pain. So connective tissue patient can have multiple complaints depending on the systemic disease, systemic organ that is involved. So the role of ANA comes when the patient has joint pains other than and along with the ANA, she has some other systemic complaints also. But ANA should never be part of any arthritis profile that usually I have seen some labs, they have made this profile. So other drawback of ANA is it can come positive in many things like lupus, it can be some drug in the scleroderma, Sjögren's, RA and polymyositis. So it doesn't give a diagnosis, it just gives a screening idea that we can have something and then we have to evaluate him or further. And there can be false positive ANA with some drugs also, especially procainamide, some tuberculosis drugs, anti-TNF inhibitor, they are quite known to cause the false positive ANA. Then some chronic liver disease also ANA can come false positive. And low titer ANA, as I told you in my previous slide also, up to especially the 1 plus titer speckled pattern can come positive in 5 to 15% of the patient. So just continuing with the hand pain, so I had this female, the 75-year-old female with a pain, especially in the DIP joint, PIP joint, which was, she was getting better with the NSAIDs. And so these were the labs and these were the joint. You can see her rheumatoid factor was positive. Again, rheumatoid factor can come low positive, especially below 50 after a certain age, especially after 60, you can get a low titer of rheumatoid factor positivity, which is usually false positive. But these kind of swelling, this is, we can typically see this is the bony swelling that we see in the osteoarthritis, what we call them in the polyarticular osteoarthritis or the osteoarthritis of the hand. And in the X-ray, you will typically find the seagull-like appearance, what we call them as. And this is a very typical sign of OA hands or inflammatory OA. So it can happen in 5% of the patient with osteoarthritis. And we, sometimes these patients, they can be very easy to manage because we have to just give the painkillers and the NSAIDs or the calcium only, but sometimes very, the pains are so severe, they may require the surgical interventions. So just getting to my last case, again, the young female with ongoing pains in the small joints of hand, there was no history of any, there was no other significant family history or the past history. Morning stiffness was significant and she had the right second DIP. DIP is the most distal joint of the finger, the distal second enlarged and tender. So whenever we are, her almost all reports were negative and she had some uric acid which was a little bit high and the treating doctor had thought that it may be due to the gout only. So whenever we talk about the, differential between the gout, osteoarthritis and psoriatic arthritis. Why psoriatic? So these are the small joints of hand and these are the patterns that we see in the different arthritis. DIP or the distal joint is the joint in which we see in the very few conditions like the psoriatic arthritis or the osteoarthritis. In the rheumatoid, usually we never see an involvement of DIP joint. So whenever the patient complains of DIP, we know either the patient has the inflammatory OA, which I told you in my last slides, or the other differential will be the psoriatic arthritis. Psoriatic arthritis can have even the DIP involvement, PIP involvement. So it can mimic the rheumatoid arthritis also, it can mimic the osteoarthritis also. But why not gout? Gout is a typically episodic monoarticular disease. Usually it starts with the first episode happens in the foot only. The pain will escalate within the maximum 8 to 12 hours. And with the treatment or even without the treatment, the patient will be better within 12 to 15 days. So this patient had a history of almost 4 months. So gout was almost out of the picture. And the second thing was the issue of the young female. The females in the premenopausal phase, due to the high estrogen level, they never develop the high uric acid level. So getting a premenopausal female, diagnosing a premenopausal female with the gout should be very highly suspicious, or there should be some enzyme deficiency in the patient. Or some other secondary factor should be there, like some drugs or something else. Otherwise, usually young females, they never develop the gout or the hyperuricemia. So this is the pattern this is the other four skeleton that I have shown. This is the typical rheumatoid arthritis. This is you can see the PIP joints or the MCP joints. While in the psoriatic arthritis skeleton, we can have this DIP joint. Back involvement, we never see in the rheumatoid arthritis patient. They develop the back pain secondarily. But back pain usually is say ankylosing spondylitis or spondyloarthropathy. There comes with the inflammatory back pain. So in this patient, you can find in the psoriasis patient, you can see for the nail changes with the DIP swelling, we know that patient has psoriatic arthritis. So psoriatic arthritis can present. They have a variable pattern. They can present like a oligoarticular presentation. They can have an ankylosing spondylitis presentation. They can have a rheumatoid arthritis like presentation. So it comes in most of the time. It comes in the differential of each and every arthritis. But the most important is the history. If the patient has psoriasis, inflammatory pain, I know that patient has psoriatic arthritis. But the nature of the pain is very important, because even the psoriatic patient can develop the non-mechanical or the osteoarthritic pain. So you have to see the nature of the pain. If the patient has inflammatory pain, patient has psoriasis, then it's a psoriatic arthritis only. And again, why is it important to differentiate? Because the drugs are little different. Prognosis is different. Most of these patients that has been to different drugs, and they can go in remission compared to rheumatoid patient, which usually requires lifelong medicines. So there are some specific feature of a psoriatic arthritis patient, like this enthesitis, which is very typical of spondyloarthropathy group. Then this dactylitis, which we see either in the psoriatic arthritis or the reactive arthritis only. So these are the specific thing. And the other specific thing, what we see in this spondyloarthropathy group, which consists of these five arthritis, like ankylosing spondylitis, reactive, or spondyloarthropathy IVD, or actually between of uveitis, or undifferentiated spondyloarthropathy, is the inflammatory back pain or involvement of the sacroiliac joint. So this is the sacroiliac joint. So, but usually the X-ray shows changes after 4 to 5 years. If we have a strong suspicion of patient having spondyloarthropathy with a history issue only just 1 or 2 years, we should always get an MRI to confirm the diagnosis, because X-ray can miss the changes in the sacroiliac joint, especially if it is taken before 3 years of onset of symptom. So this was the last group that I was discussing. Then there can be many other etiologies of the polyarthritis, like the hematochromatosis, vasculitis, sarcoidosis, and severe infection, which are not that common. It's not really, we can't cover all these things in this our today's talk. Just a little bit about the MRI. When we are using MRI, sometimes if we are with the serology is the pains are typically inflammatory, serology is negative, but we are not finding anything. At this time, we can get an MRI and we can see the changes. Like this patient had some erosion in the MRI, but the X-ray was typically normal, rheumatoid factor and other things are negative. So by MRI, we can diagnose early rheumatoid, definitely MRI can be used. Similarly, we can, if we have some good radiologists who know how to do the ultrasound of the musculoskeletal system, they can find these kind of erosions. So increased vascularity, they can tell us the patient has inflammatory arthritis. So which sometimes helps us in making the diagnosis. Talking to my second part of the day, that is the disease modified drugs. I won't take much time in this because I will just be talking about what are the newer things that we are doing. So what are the DMARDs basically? Just a little bit about the DMARDs. The routine treatment of rheumatoid arthritis, we divide into the two categories. First is the symptomatic treatment, in which consists of mostly the NSAID and sometimes the steroids. And the main treatment is consists of the disease-modified anti-rheumatic drugs. So which are the drugs which controls the disease, which can be given for the longer time, which are safer if they are taken for the longer durations, and which are the main drugs of the rheumatoid arthritis. So talking about the evolution of disease-modified drugs, so this is the therapeutic index that we of the rheumatoid arthritis. First, initially the gold star, sulfasalazine came into the picture even before the steroids in the 1940s. Then came the glucocorticoids, then the anti-malarian, then D-for-pacimen, and this changed a lot of things. The 1980s, after introduction of methotrexate. Methotrexate was first introduced in the rheumatology. It was a chemotherapy drug. Before that, it was first introduced for the myositis. Then gradually people realized that it has some role in rheumatoid arthritis. Now it is the anchor drug that the rheumatologists use. Then the leflomide, gradually come the biologics in the 2000, which really changed the treatment protocols that we have in our patients. Then newer ones or the JAK molecules, which are recently introduced, and definitely they are the they are making a lot of difference regarding the treatment decision that we, the rheumatologists, are making. So talking about the drugs, so these are the traditional disease-modified drugs, biologic disease-modified drugs, and the last two are they are not biologic DMARDs, tofacitinib and baricitinib, they are the target molecules. So talking about the traditional disease-modified drugs, if you ask any rheumatologist, which is the drug of choice whenever you want to treat a patient with rheumatoid arthritis, the answer will always be methotrexate. And why so? Because there are many factors. It's very convenient. It's a once a week therapy. It's quite cheap to the patient, hardly 200 to 300 rupees therapy for the patient. It's quite effective. Up to 20 to 30% of the patient can be managed only on the monotherapy, methotrexate monotherapy. And up to 60 to 70% on the methotrexate combined therapy. And we know that by the initially we had our reservations about the methotrexate, how safe this is, and this may cause the liver fibrosis, lung fibrosis, all those things. But now we have patients who are using methotrexate since last 30 years, and most of the rheumatologists, even most of the orthopedics and other physicians who are using this drug, they know that methotrexate is one of the safest drugs that we are using. And as a rheumatologist, we are much comfortable with this drug, and we definitely, this is the drug of choice whenever we want to start a single drug in the patient. Then the other drug, leflunomide, is a very good drug. All efficacy-wise, almost equal to the methotrexate, but had some severe side effects like the weight loss, hypertension, sometimes the leflunomide induced pneumonitis is very severe. So we always keep it as a replacement or as a reserve drug to the methotrexate. Sulfasalazine, very good drug, quite safe drug, safety-wise is one of the best drug. But the usual problem that we face is the first the size of the pill. Most of the patient, definitely they don't want to take that large pill, and the second is the gastritis that is quite common in our patients. Hydroxychloroquine, again, is a very good drug, but the disadvantage is it's not that efficacious in the rheumatoid arthritis, but it's got a very good role to play in the rheumatoid arthritis. Ecuratamide, this is a new drug. This was not approved initially, but now especially the APLA, the Asian Rheumatology Association, has approved this drug, this is found to be safe. Efficacy-wise, the trials are going on, but this is again a very good drug to as the add-on therapy. Azathioprine, cyclosporine, with a very few indications for that nowadays because of a lot of options available. But sometimes with the lung involvement, we use these drugs. So coming to the main, the newer advances, that is the biologic DMARD. Biologic DMARD are not the newer drugs, rather they are since last 20 years. Definitely the last two drugs, that is these two target molecules, that are TOFA and BASF, they are the newest drug that we are using nowadays. So what are the benefits of using traditional DMARDs? The cost-wise, they are affordable to most of our patients. Almost 72% patients, definitely they can afford those. Efficacy, we know that up to 70% patients, we can manage just with a combination of routine disease modifier. They don't require the biologics. Toxicity profile, they have their side effects, but we know each and most of the side effects of these drugs because we are using these drugs since last many, many years. So we know how to manage the toxicity of these drugs. Limitations, lack of efficacy, up to 30% of the patient, in spite of being given the best of combination, they don't improve. May not slow radiographic progression. We have seen that in spite of being used the best of combination, the radiographic progression continues few of the patient. Toxicity, we know that definitely some of the patients, they really don't tolerate any of the drugs. So these are the other reasons. So what are the other options available? That biologics consist of mainly two groups, TNF inhibitor, non-TNF, and the target molecules. Biologics, why TNF? Because TNF is the master cytokine. If you see the pathogenesis of rheumatoid arthritis, it has got role in each and every damage that we see in a patient with rheumatoid arthritis. So basically, these are the options available: etanercept, infliximab, adalimumab. We are using this since myself is using this since 2010. So they are quite definitely they have their role to play. And they are quite effective if used properly in the combination with the routine conventional DMARDs. But even we have the patients who don't respond to TNF inhibitors also. So what do we do? We can switch between the TNF. Then we have non-TNF inhibitor drugs like the tocilizumab. Tocilizumab has become quite famous due to this COVID. But this is a wonderful drug even in the rheumatoid arthritis. So it has got a really it's a dramatic improvement in the patients. But the quality, some drawbacks are there. It has got some side effects also, which can be sometimes very severe. So we have to be careful when we are using these drugs, especially the infection, altered LFT, and sometimes deranged dyslipidemia. These are the common side effects that we see that is tocilizumab. Rituximab, very good drug. It is a cost-effective wise, it is the most cost-effective biologic therapy to be offered to patients. Due to the cost effectiveness only, in India, we are using this a lot. The average cost of rituximab is 50,000 in a year, which I think most of the patients can afford. But the drawback, again, are the side effects, because a decent depletion therapy, sometimes it can be very highly immunosuppressive. So these are the biologic drugs. So as I told you, there is definite improvement in the scores like the ACR response we see, or improved swollen cytokine. There are 70% of the patients respond very well. But many patients do not achieve their treatment goal. In spite of using the biologics with the conventional DMARD, there may be patients who will not achieve the treatment goals. And these are the longer therapies. Cost is quite high. The average cost will be the 10 to 15,000 to the patient. And it has to be used for months or years and years. Rheumatoid arthritis sometimes is really difficult to taper down the doses. In ankylosing spondylitis, we usually are able to do that. But in the rheumatoid arthritis, sometimes we don't find it easy to decrease the doses of even the biologics. So that's the major drawback with this cost. And sometimes few patients, they don't respond to even these drugs. So What are the new drugs, JAK inhibitors, that recently have come to the market, like Tofacitinib, Baricitinib, and when we are using these, we know that they are efficacious, their efficacy is quite good, but again, they have their drawbacks. If you compare with the biologics, as my experience, they have got the side effects are more compared to the biologics, especially they have the liver toxicities also, they have the infection rate, same to the biologics. So they are not the ideal drug, but definitely they are better drugs. And the best part, after the generics have come to the market, they have become affordable to few class of patient that we, in which we can, in which we who are not responding, we can use the drugs and at least control the disease. And whether it's a revolution, evolution, that time will tell, because as seeing the, especially seeing the IDS profile, still we are little skeptical about how long we can use these drugs. So to at the end of summarize, so to try to, in the rheumatoid arthritis, especially if you really want to prevent the deformities, we should diagnose them as early as possible. Initial treatment started as early as possible. Treatment should be T2 target. TNF inhibitors, very good drugs, but they have their limitation. JAK inhibitor, newer therapies, quite effective, but still we have to be a little cautious when we are starting this drug. These drugs should be started only after all the baseline evaluation, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, and especially the tuberculosis pass also, we should see before starting the other biologics or the JAK inhibitor. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Excellent presentation. I mean, very crisp to the point, that too on a big topic like this. So we'll just straight away go on to the questions. So there are a few questions which have come up. The first one is from Dr. Varsha Apte. She wants to know, in a seronegative symptomatic young patient, what are the exact guideline protocols for the drugs you use, and how do you follow up these patients?
That there are a few things. That first one, whenever we see a patient of seronegative arthritis, first thing, that is a seronegative. Now, seronegative arthritis can be seronegative rheumatoid arthritis also, or it can be spondyloarthropathy also. So first thing that you have to see whether you are dealing with spondyloarthropathy or you are dealing with seronegative rheumatoid. So if you are dealing with a spondyloarthropathy, as I explained in my slides, they are the proximal joints, big joints like the knee, ankle, olivoarticular, asymmetrical. So if the patient has this kind of pattern, most likely patient has a spondyloarthropathy, and so even the psoriatic arthritis. Psoriatic arthritis mimic the rheumatoid arthritis, and it can be seronegative. So depending on the patient, if the patient pattern is fitting more in the rheumatoid arthritis, my protocols will be same. What I do is the rheumatoid arthritis, like I will start with the methotrexate, I will add the hydroxychloroquine, then I will, if the patient don't respond, then I will add the sulfasalazine or the leflunomide. But if the patient, the pattern-wise patient, to me, it looks like more of a spondyloarthropathy, then I think that we use more sulfasalazine in the spondyloarthropathy group, then we add the methotrexate. So depending on the pattern and depending on my clinical diagnosis, I will treat this patient. But if you feel the patient has rheumatoid arthritis, the protocols of the rheumatoid arthritis, seronegative and seropositive rheumatoid arthritis are almost same.
Right. And so how frequently do you follow up with these patients?
The most of the time, the each and every drugs, it takes time to start acting. There is no need of asking patient to come before after 2 weeks or 3 weeks, because the drugs will take at least 4 to 6 weeks. So usually the first visit, I ask the patient to come after a month to assess if the patient responding or not. If he is responding to the treatment, I ask him to come after 2 or 3 months. But if I feel that disease is still active, I still had to adjust the dosage, then I again ask to come after 4 weeks. So initially, few visits are 2 to 3 visits are after 4 weeks only. But when the disease drugs doses are adjusted and the disease looks under control, then usually we ask to come patient around after 3 months. And if disease is quite under control, then after 6 months also.
Absolutely. Perfect. Perfect, sir. Coming to the next one, this is from Dr. Shashank Kanchan. He wants your advice on intra-articular steroid injections for the small joints of the hands. So what is your say on that, sir?
Now, intra-articular injections, again, they are the very good additive treatment that we have and that we use. We use a lot of them in the knees, in the small joints also, but you have to be very specific when you want to use them, because most of the time, if the patient has more than two joint swelling, you usually don't give the intra-articular. Rather, we step up the therapy. If the patient has multiple joint swelling, then we know that the therapy that we are giving is under the doses are not proper, so we have to adjust the dosage. But if a patient has swelling only in the one joint or two joint, then definitely we can give them. But even if even after giving the intra-articular, you have to little bit adjust your doses, because even the swelling is coming or swelling is persisting single joint, that means that it is still little active. So you can, it's a single joint, and definitely rather than giving the answer for a longer time, we can inject that joint and adjust the doses of the disease modified drugs.
Perfect, perfect, sir. So this question has come from Ruma TV. What does an ANA speckled or weakly positive means?
ANA has got multiple patterns, like the homogeneous pattern, nuclear pattern, speckled pattern. ANA weakly speckled pattern is the most common pattern we see in the normal population.
Okay.
Up to 25% of the normal population can have ANA 1 plus speckled. So whenever there are some reports, because this is a very subjective test, ANA has to be seen by the pathologist by himself or the rheumatologist or pathologist who is doing the test. And it has the grading, the depending on the intensity of the immunofluorescence, we give the grading as a 1 plus, 2 plus, 3 plus. If the intensity is high, it's a 3 plus or 4 plus. If the low intensity, 1 plus or 2 plus. So 1 plus is like a plus minus thing. Sometimes we are not sure whether it's a positive or negative. So that is the grading that 1 plus has. So 1 plus is more like a normal only. So if the patient is that you are getting the 1 plus speckle, if the patient is not fitting into the connected tissue, we should ignore this. Ideally, it should be at least 2 plus intensity if we really take it as a significant ANA.
Absolutely. Perfect, sir. This is from Dr. Rahman. He wants to know the differential diagnosis of a one ankle joint with pain and swelling. No history of trauma, just pain and swelling in one ankle.
Ankle is a joint which can be involved in many things. So whenever a patient with just ankle pain and swelling comes to the first thing, as you said, that we look for the trauma or the some sprain. But as an orthopedic, you can better just those things, definitely. For a rheumatologist point of view, if a patient comes with an ankle swelling, my first differential with a spondyloarthropathic, especially sometimes the ankle is in spondylitis, undifferentiated spondyloarthropathy can present like this. Second will be again the psoriatic arthritis, same from the same group. And third will be the sarcoid. Sarcoid can present like this. Even the vasculitis sometimes can present like this. If the history of short within 7 days, then I will see for the gout also. But if the history is more than 2 weeks, then gout will be ruled out. So these three or four, even sometimes monoarticular rheumatoid arthritis, very unlikely. I will keep it in the last, but definitely still I have to see that. But only ankle swelling, the first will be spondyloarthropathy group, second will be sarcoidosis. If the patient is systemic complaint, then it will be the vasculitis.
Perfect, perfect, sir. So another question, this is from Dr. Santosh Babu. He wants to know, before you start biologics, what are the base minimum tests you need to do before initiating this therapy?
The baseline test that we need in each and every patient, the CBC, CRP, SGPT, creatinine, the baseline. Other than that, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, and the quantiferent TB gold. And sometimes if the patient has history of anorexia, weight loss, or some cough, we may ask to get a CT scan also.
So if anti-CCP comes negative, but all the other tests are positive, but all the other signs and symptoms are positive, then do we treat them still as rheumatoid arthritis and go on?
So the first thing of any arthritis, to diagnose any arthritis, is the synovitis. The first thing that you should get is the pain and swelling without any history of trauma. So that if you have the synovitis, and as an orthopedic surgeon, I am very sure that you can diagnose the synovitis. You can examine, you know how to examine the, and you can palpate and see if the patient has synovitis or not. So if the patient has any joint pain and swelling, any synovitis without any history of trauma, that means patient has arthritis, which needs to be treated. So whether to start on the disease modified drug or not, that's a little bit, that's a question that you will ask. So that classification, the newer classification that I showed, that can help you in that. But patient has synovitis, most of this patient, 90% of the patient, they require treatment. Whether now it says like a spondyloarthropathy or the rheumatoid arthritis, then it depends on the pattern of the joint. So you should, you don't go by the reports. Reports can come negative sometimes. Rather, I am attached to BJ also. In the BJ, we really hardly see the reports. Most of the time, 50% of the patient, we really can't get the anti-CCP or ANA done. So just we go by clinical plan, and we treat this disease, and most of the patients do well. So your clinical judgment is more important than any lab.
Perfect. Perfect. Right. So thank you, sir, for that excellent presentation, and how well you have taken all these questions is absolutely brilliant. So as you know, sir, we are still fighting the second wave. It's coming down so far. And that best way is to stay at home, stay safe, and stay protected. So with this, I, Dr. Salim Patel, the medical advisor to Zydus Sinovia, would thank you for your presence and thank Dr. Neeraj for his broadcasting today, as well as for our internal team of HIDOC. So wish you all to be